Good morning, students. Today, let us continue from ferromagnetism. Okay. Now, what is ferromagnetism? When we keep a substance in an external magnetic field, it is strongly attracted in the direction of the applied magnetic field. Then, that substance is called ferromagnetic substance, and the phenomenon is known as ferromagnetism. Okay. Now, ferromagnetism is observed in magnetically concentrated substances. In these substances, the paramagnetic metal ions allow their total electron spins to interact with one another through exchange interaction. Okay. The exchange interaction is possible as the metal ions containing unpaired electrons are not isolated from one another. All right. The total electron spin vectors of ions or atoms in a ferromagnetic substance are all coupled parallel to one another in a group of or domains. There are many such domains in a ferromagnetic substance. The magnetic moments of these domains are oriented randomly in the absence of external magnetic field. Okay, and the resultant magnetic moment becomes zero. When it is placed in an external magnetic field, the magnetic moments of all domains start aligning parallel to the direction of the external magnetic field. All right. Now, ferromagnetism is observed in magnetically concentrated substances. Next slide. The tendency of magnetic moments align in the presence of external magnetic field opposed by the thermal agitation. Now, thermal agitation is not always able to randomize the magnetic moments once they have been allied. This results in the retention of magnetic moments of domains in ferromagnetic substances even after the external magnetic field is removed, and that is called what? Hysteresis. Okay. Now, which are the examples? Ferric oxide, ferrous sulfate, both solids, and then manganese sulfate. Okay. Next slide. Anti-ferromagnetism. Now, what is anti-ferromagnetism? When a paramagnetic substance is cooled to a low temperature, at a particular temperature, the magnetic susceptibility begins to decrease. Okay. This critical temperature is called nil temperature. All right. It is represented by the symbol TN. Now, below the nil point, the magnetic susceptibility of paramagnetic substance goes on decreasing with the increase in temperature. Okay. This behavior of paramagnetic substance is known as anti-ferromagnetism, and such substances are called anti-ferromagnetic substances. Okay. Now, which are the examples for this? Manganese oxide. Okay. And then potassium, nickel, and then trifluoro, okay, this compound, complex compound, and then K2OACl6, Fe2CO9, okay. So these are the examples for this. Next line. Below TN, the thermal energy available to an anti-ferromagnetic substance is less than the energy of electron spin pair interaction. Okay. Below nil temperature for anti-ferromagnetic substances, the magnetic susceptibility X is directly proportional to the temperature T. All right. Next slide. Mechanism of pairing of total electron spin. Okay. The electron spin interactions leading to the coupling of total electron spins of the neighboring metal atom or ions occur through the intervening diamagnetic ions or atoms, even if the paramagnetic metal ions are close to each other. So, here is an example of manganese oxide. Okay. You can see here the structure exchange of electron spins taking place in manganese and oxygen. O2 minus, this is O2 minus, this is manganese on one side and the other side also manganese. Manganese, you know the electronic configuration, atomic number 25, electronic 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 3d5, 4s2. In d orbital or 3d orbital, it has got 5 electrons. Okay. Next line. In manganese oxide, each manganese ion has a half-filled d orbital. 3d5 means it has got 5 half-filled orbitals. Okay, that means 5 electron. That means 3d orbital is half-filled. Okay, so this is the manganese. 5 electrons you can see here. Here also it should be 5, but here only 4 is mentioned. 1 is missing. Okay, it should be 5 here. And then O2 minus having 2 electrons. Okay. Next slide. Example: manganese oxide and nickel oxide, and then KMF2, where M is bivalent paramagnetic metal ion. All right. Intermolecular ferromagnetism occurs when the electron spins of the metal ions belonging to the same molecule of the polynuclear chemical species get coupled. Next line. In copper acetate, Cu2OOC CH3 4 times 2H2, this type of antiferromagnetism exists. Only the spin magnetic moment contributes towards mu effective of a magnetically concentrated substance, and the energy of the spin interaction delta E is given by delta E is equal to J into Si into Sk. Okay, let this equation be 15. All right. Now what is Si and Sk? Si and Sk are the total electron spin of the ith and kth metal atoms, metal ions of the substance. J is known as the exchange coupling constant and is a measure of the strength of interaction between total electron spin of the metal ions. If J is positive, then the total spin S of all the paramagnetic ions in the magnetically constant substance in the ground state get aligned in the same direction. This phenomenon is known as ferromagnetism. If J is positive, then the total electron spin S of all paramagnetic ions in the magnetically constant substance in the ground state are paired up. This phenomenon is known as antiferromagnetism. Okay. Now, temperature dependence of magnetic properties, Curie's law. Now, what is Curie's law? Pierre Curie established in 1895 the paramagnetic susceptibility is inversely proportional to the absolute temperature. Okay. Now, how do you represent mathematically? Xi m is inversely proportional to the temperature, that is 1 by T, or Xi m is equal to C by T. Okay, let this be equation be 1. Now, what is C? C is the Curie constant and is characteristic of the substance. Okay, this expression is called Curie's law. Curie's law is obeyed by paramagnetic substances that are magnetically dilute. The magnetic dilute means paramagnetic center is well separated by diamagnetic atom. When we plot xi m against absolute temperature, a parabolic curve is obtained as shown in this figure. This is parabolic curve obtained. Okay. But if you plot reciprocal of xi m, that is the second diagram, at different temperature against absolute temperature, a straight line passing through the origin is obtained. This is the graph. Okay. Straight line passing through the origin is obtained, and the slope of the line gives what? C. Okay. Next slide. It is observed that in many cases line does not pass through the origin. It cuts the temperature axis either below or above 0 degree Kelvin. This requires same modification of Curie equation. Okay. Now, this is the plot of reciprocal of magnetic susceptibility versus what? Temperature for three magnetic behaviors. Okay, you can see here three magnetic behaviors. A graph indicates Curie's law for a paramagnetic substance. B curve, Curie-Weiss law for the ferromagnetic substance. Okay. C, Curie-Weiss law for an antiferromagnetic substance with a near temperature Tn. Okay. Next slide. Now, what is Curie-Weiss law? To explain the above deviation, Curie law was modified and is given as xi m is equal to C by T minus theta. Okay. Now, what is theta? Where theta is another constant known as Weiss constant. It is the temperature at which the line cuts the temperature axis. This modified equation is called Curie-Weiss law. Okay. This Weiss constant takes into account the intermolecular interactions. The magnetic moment can be calculated for such substances by the equation mu is equal to 2.828 square root of xi m into t minus theta. Okay. The ferromagnetic behavior of a substance exists up to a particular temperature known as Curie temperature or Curie point. Above this temperature, the ferromagnetic substance behaves as a normal paramagnetic substance. Okay. Now, next, what is the Neel temperature? The anti-ferromagnetic behavior of substance exists up to a particular temperature known as Neel temperature or Neel point, above which the anti-ferromagnetic substance behaves as a normal paramagnetic substance. Okay. So, this curve shows the variation of magnetic susceptibility with temperature for dia, para, ferro and anti-ferromagnetic substance. Transition to paramagnetic behavior for ferro and anti-ferro substance occur at TC and TN respectively. Okay. Now, next is a tabular column, okay, showing the comparison of magnetic properties. You can see here diamagnetism, okay, diamagnetism and then origin of magnetism and then effect of external magnetic field, specific the susceptibility, temperature dependence and then field dependence. Okay. So, for diamagnetism, paramagnetism, ferromagnetism and then anti-ferromagnetism. Okay. Now, next line, experimental determination of magnetic susceptibility by Guis method. Okay. So, this is the method to determine what magnetic susceptibility. Now, what is the principle of Guis method? Finely powdered, okay, it is not powered, finely powdered complex compound is closely packed into the up to the mark, okay, in a pyrous glass tube called Guis tube. The difference in weight denotes the force F acting on the sample to draw into the field. It is given by the equation. So, force is given by the equation F is equal to half H squared K. Let this be equation 1. Okay. Next line. F is equal to half h squared k minus k dash, that let this be equation 2, where k is the volume susceptibility of air. Then F is equal to half into h squared k minus k dash plus delta, okay, plus delta, and then that is let this be equation 3. Okay. For a sample of constant length and cross section area, the factor h squared is a constant. By introducing the density of the sample, the above equation is rewritten as, okay. So, introducing what density, we can rewrite the equation as 10 to the power 6 is equal to alpha plus beta f dash divided by m, okay. Now, what is alpha? Where alpha is a constant allowing for the displaced air and is equal to 0.029 into specimen volume of the sample, okay. What is beta? Beta is a tube calibrated constant. Okay. So, this is beta. Now, next procedure, how to determine delta. Okay. Delta is equal to minus delta W1 into G. Okay. How you got this? The determination of delta. A clean and dry Guis tube is suspended into the electronic balance between the two poles of electromagnet. Okay. It is shown here. Two poles of electromagnet. The weight of Guis tube, okay, that weight of Guis tube is determined once in out of the field and then in the field, okay, one out of the field and one inside in the field. The difference of the weight, that is delta W1 multiplied with G to get what? Delta, okay, that is how we got delta is equal to minus delta W1 into G, okay, where G is a gravitational constant, okay. Next is how to determine F dash. The Guis tube is filled with the complex compound up to the mark with close packing. Okay. It is suspended to the electronic balance in between the poles of the electromagnet as shown in the diagram. Okay. The weight of the sample is determined once in out of the field and then in the field. The difference in weight delta W2 is calculated. Then F and F dash are calculated. F is equal to W2, okay, into what? G. Okay. This is the formula. What is F dash? F dash is equal to F minus delta. Okay. Next slide. Determination of beta. Now, how do you determine beta? The Guis tube is emptied, cleaned and dried. It is filled with HgCONC 4 times complex up to the mark with close packing. It is weighed in the absence and then in the presence of magnetic field. Okay. The laboratory temperature is noted by knowing xi of the calibrant at the given temperature, and then you calculate what beta. Okay. Next, determination of alpha. How do you determine alpha? The same GUI's tube is emptied, washed and drained. It is filled with distilled water up to the mark. Okay. And then weighed. The volume of the sample is calculated using density of water at the lab temperature. Now, volume of the sample is given by weight of water divided by density, okay, density of water. The value alpha is equal to 0.029 into volume of the sample, okay. Next, the calculation of xi m correction, okay, how do you calculate? Substituting the values of alpha, beta and f dash, and in the equation m in the equation 4, the magnetic susceptibility is calculated, okay. The experimentally determined value of magnetic susceptibility will consist of contributions from both paramagnetic and diamagnetic susceptibilities. Therefore, it is to be corrected by substituting diamagnetic contributions from ligands present in the complex compound. The diamagnetic contributions from ligands can be calculated using Pascal's constant, that is, okay. Therefore, corrected susceptibility is equal to, okay, xi correction is equal to measured susceptibility minus diamagnetic contributions from ligands, and molar susceptibility is equal to xi correction, okay, into m. All right, next slide. Next is calculation of mu effective and number of unpaired electrons n. The magnetic moment mu f effective, okay, then be calculated using the equation mu effective is equal to square root of xi m corrected into T Bohr magneton. The number of unpaired electrons is calculated by using the formula. How do you calculate number of unpaired electrons? Mu effective is equal to square root of n into n plus 2 Bohr magneton. Okay, then next result. So, what is the result? Molar magnetic susceptibility of the coordination compound, that is equal to so many cm cube per mole, and then next result, the magnetic moment of the coordination compound is so much Bohr magneton. Okay. Next slide. Sources of error. Now, which are the sources of error? First one, the lateral oscillation of the GUI's tube, okay, containing sample may cause error in weighing. Okay, therefore, the apparatus must be kept in an oscillation free environment. Next, a loose packing of the sample leads to error in the volume of the sample. All right. Then third one is, there can be balance error in noting the change of weight of the sample. Okay. Next, factors determining paramagnetism of transition metal complexes. Now, which are the factors? The paramagnetism of transition metal complex depends upon four factors. Okay. Now, which are the four factors? The number of unpaired d and f electrons, okay, the strength and symmetry of the electrostatic field arising from the ligands present in the complex compound, third one, spectroscopic ground state and spin state of the complex, and fourth one, occupancy of the various levels at a given temperatures. Okay. Now, the first one, spin only groups. The magnetic moment of these complexes can be calculated by spin only formula. And what is the spin only formula? Mu ft is equal to mu s is equal to square root of n into n plus 2 Bohr magneton. Okay. Now, B, group with small multiplet separation. Okay. How do you represent that? Delta E is less than kT. The energy separation between different J states depends upon the extent of spin orbit coupling. Okay, it depends upon spin orbit coupling. When the spin orbit coupling is to the small extent, the energy separation between the J states are small compared to kT. In such cases, capital L, okay, capital L and S interact separately and independently with external magnetic field. Therefore, in complex ions belonging to this group, the orbital contribution is neither large nor insignificant to be ignored. The observed magnetic moment is higher than mu s, but not equal to mu s plus L. Okay. In these complex ions, the orbital contribution is not totally quenched because of insufficient shielding of the spin free electrons. This type of behavior is observed in a few 3D transition metal complexes of cobalt 2 and nickel 2. Okay. The magnetic moments of these complex ions are calculated by the formula mu j is equal to mu effective is equal to g into square root of j into j plus 1 Bohr magneton. Okay, so I stop at this stage. Alright, so please go through all the slides. Any difficulty, please contact me. Okay, thank you.